President Nana Addo-Dankwa-Akufo-Addo has made his choice on who replaces former chairperson of the Electoral Commission, Mrs. Charlotte Osei, and her deputies. However, the NDC is not happy with those choices. Are the concerns raised by the NDC valid, or is just payback time? To discuss this and more, I have with me Honorable Rashid Pelpuo, Member of Parliament for WAS Central, and Honorable Ntim Fordjour, Member of Parliament for Assin South Constituency. My name is Nana Akusia Kunedu Asante Samuels, and you are watching The Hard Truth. We are proudly brought to you by Murphy Homes, Dawa Industrial City, Pulse Fitness Gym, and White Bath Academy. You're watching The Hard Truth, Member of Parliament for WAS Central, Honorable Rashid Pelpuo, and Member of Parliament for Assin South Constituency, Reverend Ntim Fordjour. It's your welcome to The Hard Truth, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Regular guest, it's your first time here and we are privileged to have you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
It's great having you on the show. But weeks after sacking of the former EC boss, Mrs. Charlotte Osei, and her two deputies, President Akufo-Addo has nominated replacement Ms. or Mrs. Jean Mensah as a new EC. The NDC is not really happy about the president's choice. What are your views on this? I'll start with you, team.
In respect of the nomination of Mrs. Jean Mensah, she's a woman that I know personally. I've interacted with IEA for some time now, taking part in their regular forum and research and other engagement, such civil society, another policy, you know, engagement. And over the years, Mrs. Jean Mensah has been one lawyer and one policy activist that has conducted herself, you know, above board and in all fairness and neutrality. She has earned the confidence and trust of the multiplicity of political actors we have in civil society organizations, international organizations. She has earned their respect, and she couldn't, I in my view, have held the position that at this point in time, considering the critical state that the Electoral Commission has been plunged into following the scandals and which occasioned the Commission of Inquiry to be constituted constitutionally in accordance with Article 146 of the Constitution, and eventually saw the removal of the three chairpersons, it's some harm has been caused to the integrity
but the
and
president
credibility
could have waited
of
for the outcome of the court or the court decision. No,
there will be various, you know, various views about how the constitutional interpretations are done, and that at any point in time can come up. Any well-meaning Ghanaian can seek their opinion and seek interpretation of an article or two in the Constitution, but that cannot delay the constitution of full complement of the Electoral Management Body. And again, back to the point I was making, at this point in time, the expectation of not only Ghanaians, but even the world over who have keen interest in the consolidation of democracy in Ghana, the expectation is this, that steps must be taken towards restoring credibility, towards restoring integrity, towards restoring any damage that may have been caused to the Electoral Management Body as a result of the accusations and counter-accusations, which in my view could have been avoided, but subsequently led to the application of Article 146, which saw the removal of the three chairpersons. Madam Jean Mensah comes on board with creditable, you know, experience, having been the executive director of IEA for some time now, and having seen how the successful conduct of presidential debates and how the interactions with all the major political actors and even the minor political actors, civil society organizations, and every stakeholder that matter in our democratic dispensation. And indeed, she has distinguished herself, and at this point in time, there couldn't have been a more suitable person. And I know that deep in the hearts of my friends in the minority, they have deep respect for the integrity, the credibility, the neutrality, the fairness and independence of Madam Jean Mensah.
I see.
And for that, they agree. And the context, they had interacted with her on many occasions. Of course, my observation is this. For the fact that there had been occasions where Party A had had cause to think that, oh, you didn't favor me as IEA, and Party B had also raised, you didn't favor, they felt they were not favored in certain areas, all put together, and it's not skewed. It's cut across. It just shows that this is a woman who acts, you know, according to conviction and procedures without fear or favor. And so she will be most suitable to occupy the sensitive position of the chairperson of the Electoral Commission. I would want to congratulate her on her nomination.
But Rashid, your party released a statement describing the nomination of Mrs. Mensah as a choice that defy all senses of, you know, decency, fairness and justice. Isn't that rather harsh? And, you know, are you opposing the president's decision, you know, for all the wrong reasons, some seem to believe?
Well, this is a very sensitive matter. Electoral matters are sensitive matters, and we don't want to see a situation where we degenerate into conflicting ideas about who leads us into the elections. Mm-hmm. And also to have a feeling of suspicion that there has been some feeling, some intentional orchestration to make sure that another commissioner you are taking has something to do with government, and that government can remotely control that person. If there is a feeling like that, then there is a problem. You have the opposite side consistently showing discontent and unhappiness and, you know, speaking about it. It's the same thing happened when Charlotte Osei was picked. You know, people called her prostitute, called her nicknames, friend, girlfriend of somebody, and also said she was not competent. She had lots of background challenges and et cetera, and wasn't fit for the job. And now you can see the same thing playing out. You see, so there is some amount of suspicion between the two political parties. Now, whatever you do, they evoke some sentiments which might not be in tune.
So you don't agree with your party stance?
Why not? I play to my party. I work along with the party. I wouldn't contradict them because they see more than I see as a group. My thinking is that there definitely is a problem, and that government must address that problem to make sure we come to terms with the reality, and that the person chosen is acceptable to all of them. I would encourage government to engage the party, to listen to the party, to see what we can do, you know, to straighten up the edges and make sure we are in tune with the times. Mm. As a person, Jean Mensah is a very good person. I've met her severally. She's done a lot of work and committed to serving the people. But she ran into trouble with the NDC, with the IEA, and the kinds of things that people are now talking about now. And I don't oppose the people who talk about it, because we must be given the opportunity to say what could have made her a better choice, you know. So presently, I would think that we should be moving towards a certain conclusion of understanding of what exactly we want, you know, as a people. Mm. That this is why we thought that the speedy removal of the chairperson, you know, the former chairperson, shouldn't have happened the way it happened. And again, the president should have taken time also to listen to what the court was going to say about issues that are bordering on it, that are already in court, you know. But if you are in a hurry to do something which people would talk about, which touches on the lives of people, which eventually is going to have a determination, will have an effect on the determination of the electoral process that we are embarking on, you don't have to hurry about it. He should have given room enough for consultation, as he himself said when he was in opposition. Mm. He was the opposition leader quite recently, just less than 2 years ago. And when Charlotte Osei was appointed, she complained very bitterly of lack of consultation, and that there was a need to consult the opposition then, and also to listen to their views, and there was a need to have wider consultation about it. He didn't do any of those things he exhorted and thought was good for Ghana. Oh. And he rushed into it. So it is normal that
people would come out with these things that will contradict what his expectations are.
But then again,
are.
It is well known that the NDC, had some bad blood with Madame Mensa in 2012, the IA debate, and I'm sure the president is aware of it. Do you think that the president considers this as not being so relevant and hence his nominations?
That would have been the major reason why you should reach out to the opposition. Mm. Because the person you appoint is not just for the president. It's not for the MPP. It's for Ghana. It's for all political parties. It's for everybody who goes to the polls and indeed determines the future and fortune of this country. So doing a consultation with a suspicion that this person may have problems with the NDC would have been the way forward. You know, like I'm saying, many of us think that, if you see the person, you cannot doubt the competence of the person. But the quality that made her who she is what people are doubting and are questioning. And so they should have been given the opportunity to have their input. Even if you have your input and the president has his way, it's still something you can step on and say, look, we did consultations, we met you, you raised these issues, we gave you these responses before the appointments was done. I think Nana Akufo-Addo, as he is, I think that he has a very good background of somebody who has been trained himself so well into the job. He's got a good existential experience, and that could have given him the grounding for him to have achieved this without necessarily creating this problem we are in. Respecting the courts, respecting people's opinion, respecting political opinion, political party opinions, and then eventually you come out, even if it is sham consultation, it's still consultation.
So you think that the president is not really considering the opinions of the opposition?
Yeah, at this stage, we are at the nomination stage, and the rest of the processes, approval processes, will be undertaken. There will be opportunity for every concerned group or individuals who may have some reservations to so express, even particularly at the vetting level, where the nominee will appear before the appointment committee. That is where that's the opportune time, even for various stakeholders to channel their petitions, to channel their reservations if there are. And so the president hasn't jammed the gun. There's been extensive consultations and the listening from comments from various sections of the media, from civil society organizations, international organizations. One could observe a wide acceptation of this nomination. You recall the comment that was passed by the outgoing U.S. ambassador in respect of the suitability of Madam Jane Mensa as the incoming electoral commissioner, and that was very positive. And it's a reflection of the many views of the majority in Ghana. But in any case, one would not be able to wait until a case that has been filed
why?
In the court.
To, why?
One may not be able to predict the time. People have the purview and within the remit of their rights to file
suits.
So
what if
the filing of
what if the court clears them and says, oh,
and that is
a
point.
Nothing.
And that is a point that I'm
what
making.
What happened? Do they go back to their position?
And that is a point that I'm making. Whilst the constitutional procedure is being undertaken, at any point in time, even following the approval of the nominee and having sat in the chair as a substantive electoral commissioner, if any court ruling should come up which has implication for her status, it could so apply at any point in time. So at any point in time, these petitions even could. So the fact that the nomination has come at this point in time and not having to wait until the finality and conclusion, which is indefinite, which one cannot predict. And the role of the mandate of the Electoral Commission is a very sensitive role, which cannot wait, which has to properly be constituted, a full complement constituted. And here, we are not talking about a regional electoral commissioner or a district electoral commissioner. We are talking about the very core in our local adage. We have a lot. We place a lot of importance to the headship and the leadership. And so, if the leadership of the electoral commission, the electoral management body, so sensitive an institution in our democratic dispensation, is not properly constituted, and the excuse is to wait until every lawsuit has been finalized, that will not be prudent. But again, One observation that people have made, which calls for worry, is the trajectory that my friends on the minority seem to be going consistently. It appears that any time President Akufo-Addo had to make a sensitive appointment, regardless where the background of the people, NDC had raised issues.
To the extent
that even at the appointment of Mr. Martin Amidu, a former presidential running mate of the NDC, a former Attorney General and Minister of Justice of the NDC, having been appointed to the sensitive position of the Office of the Special Prosecutor, NDC raised reservations. And so I am not surprised that even when a known neutral, who has distinguished herself in the field of public policy, think tank, and matters of elections and governance and democracy, having interacted with multiplicity of political actors, CSOs, and international organizations, and having carved, you know, that niche for herself already, they are coming up with unfounded reservations. However, if those reservations,
for the sake of time, I think you need to
they will have opportunity.
End on your point.
They will have the opportunity even at the vetting to so raise.
Great, but I remember Professor Ransford Jampo, director of the Center for European Studies at the University of Ghana. He has said that the NDC is allowing pettiness to, you know, cloud their judgment on Madame Jane Mensah. Are you being petty, Rashid?
Those are the things that people, the kinds of pronouncements people make, and then they come back to haunt them. If this person of such high profile personality cannot see the essence of opposition, then we are in trouble. I don't know what Professor Jampo wants from this comment that he has made. What does he mean by being petty? A political party that is in opposition represents the other side of the people who would question every move where there is a suspicion that that move is not in the best interest of the people. Here is a case which, a situation where the president, a nominee, or the sacking of an earlier commissioner evoked a court action. And then he wouldn't even wait for 1 week to find out whether the court action is going to have any effect on the future nomination of a candidate or not. He goes ahead to nominate a candidate. Here is a situation where, in doing so, there was the need for him to have done some wide consultation. According to his own dictates, according to his own opinion that he evoked in the last, just before 2016, he didn't follow that dictate. And here is a situation where the opposition had feeling of suspicion that there must be some, or there could be, some political reason why that person was chosen. You are calling that petty.
I remember he claimed that the NDC had evidence, you know, to suggest that Mrs. Jane Mensah, visits the president often. Isn't this petty? I mean, is this an evidence enough to question her neutrality?
Now, when somebody questions the reason why you are saying that, and then he said, well, I feel that he's a political animal, and I feel that he's so such that he even has constant meeting with the president. And then,
but by seeing the president, does that warrant, you know?
No, I'm saying that if somebody accuses, if he says that, look, this person you are appointing is not apolitical. He has so much leaning on a political party. There's evidence to that. They say, what evidence is it? They say, okay, I've seen that he's been visiting the president all the time. And if I'm not quoting him. I wouldn't bring that as an evidence. It is enough for me to say that, look, if I think that he has some political leaning, to insist that he has some political leaning, and that pronouncement he has made, ABCD, has proven it. I may not go ahead to say because he has visited the president, because I haven't seen that. But if he has said that, what it means is that there is a compounded belief that the woman has a lot to do with the political party that has from which the president emerges from. Yeah. But let me say, he's talking about consultation after nomination. Nobody does that.
No, I didn't. That was not.
He said that there will be vetting.
Vetting and then.
And so that's where we can have our input. Mm-hmm. That input is unnecessary. We may even not attend the. We may. I'm not saying we will not. If we decide not to be part of it, it will still go ahead. If we decide to be part of it, it will still go ahead.
So you suggest what, we wait for the court, you know, outcome?
I wish we had waited for the court to take a decision. Mm-hmm. So we explore all, because he talked about something which is very important, that electoral issues are so important that we should explore all the dimensions and that we can't wait. That's contradictory. If we say they are so important, we explore all the issues. Therefore, we should wait to make sure the writing is done. You see, so essentially, I think that the government and all the supporters of government who are at the side and listening and commenting should respect the views of the opposition and take everything that we say on board. We might not overturn this. We may not have the capacity to overturn it, but we have a say. Let the say be taken into consideration. Don't brush it aside and talk to and call people petty when being petty does not apply in this matter. Mm-hmm. So I think that we've gotten to a very critical point in our political life, and we need to take care of that. And the emerging trend of opposing every time
appointments
are made, especially of the Electoral Commission, and people are coming to say bad things about the person, must stop.
Mm.
We have to come to a point when we have to stop it.
Right.
And it will stop where we prescribe and insist on wide consultation before such appointments are made.
We'll be right back.
When you dream.
Are you searching for something new in education for your child? Look no further. Alpha White Park Academy is here. Imagine an institution with a mission to facilitate the holistic development of every child enrolled. Imagine a school that provides excellent teaching, grounded in godly character, without any form of discrimination. Imagine an academy with a well-equipped computer lab and a library stocked with relevant books. Your imaginations are within reach with Alpha White Park Academy. At Alpha White Park Academy, a multi-skilled and Montessori approach is incorporated into our scheme for your child and infant school. We combine Ghana Education Service and other globally relevant curricula for your child in primary and junior high levels to have the best of educational experience. Our staff are highly qualified and well motivated to care for your child's every need. Security is provided to ensure safety of your child. Locate Alpha White Park Academy at number AE401/10. Aquile Kaswa, behind the Living God and close to the Credit Union Training Center. Digital address code is CX0443030. Call us on 0502-261-944 or 0544-188-045. Rush now to Alpha White Pack Academy and enroll your child. Alpha White Pack Academy. Education makes.
When you dream, dream big.
Welcome back to The Hard Truth, and we are proudly brought to you by Murphy Homes, Dawa Industrial City, Pulse Fitness Gym, and Alpha White Park Academy. I have the Honorable Rashid Pelpuo, Member of Parliament for WA Central, and Honorable Ntim Fordjour is also the Member of Parliament for Assin South Constituency. Welcome to The Hard Truth again. But Rashid, I remember Member for Parliament for, I think, Sanarigu, is it, am I right? Mm-hmm. Sanarigu, if you say any beliefs, that the NPP is, you know, packing the Electoral Commission with and its sympathizers in order to rig the 2020 elections. Elections are won, you know, at the polling station. How will Mrs. Jean Mensa rig the election in favor of the NPP?
The Electoral Commissioner is a returning officer. He announces the election results. If he makes any mistake and announces anything, that is it.
Wow. How?
You may hardly have to go to court.
How?
Yes.
How can she make a mistake? So there's a polling stations.
I'm making a point.
Right, I'm listening.
If she decides to announce anything, that is it. But you want somebody who has high level standards of objectivity and neutrality to be the arbiter and to be the overseer of our elections, so that in the end, nobody has a doubt that the results we are getting are the true reflection of the voices of the people.
Rashid, Mrs. Charlotte Ose was appointed by President Mahama.
Yes.
Your government.
Yes.
Who won the last election? The NPP.
Yes.
So what do you say to that?
Well, it's not the question, it's not the issue I'm raising. In fact, the last electoral commissioner, Dr. Afarijan, was appointed by an NDC government, but Kufuor won the elections, you know, and then these things, they can happen. But I'm saying that's the kind of voice we want to see. That's the kind of personality we want to see. Somebody who will not attempt to throw the nation into jeopardy because of an election verdict. And so high level of objectivity, high standard of morality, high acceptability by both parties are critical elements in appointing an electoral commissioner. So if you see people talking like that, there are issues you need to consider. But these things are all arising because of the failure of the president to slow down his haste, just a little. Slow down, do consultation, slow down, respect the courts. And eventually, if anything comes out of it, Ghanaians would have been seeing themselves, look, you were consulted, all these things you are taking were taken on board, but you were given responses and they were adequate responses. The court has taken a decision. That is the court. That's us. And it's reflecting the opinion of the people. It's reflecting the judgment of the Supreme Court. And in according to the Constitution, that is what settles everything. And so nobody has anything to say. But if you appear not to want to listen to the people, which is an aberration as far as democracy is concerned, and appear to sidestep the ruling of a court, which is also an unacceptability as far as our democracy is concerned, you'll be running into trouble with the people. The voice of the people is very critical. And so I think that all these things emerging, the views of people coming to the surface, a political party making a big pronouncement about the choice of candidates or the choice of a commissioner, are issues that are brought about by the president himself. And I think that he should address them right now so that we don't move into the face of the electoral process. He's chosen somebody who, personally, I have no reason to criticize because of the character and personality.
You said that already, but Ntim, yeah. what do you
But the fact that that person may have some political leanings and may have some feeling of suspicion, evoke or bring about some feeling of suspicion with the NDC is something that we all have to
be
mindful about.
What do you make
there
of
are
that?
Three basic factors that I want to establish. And number one, let me just even cite this example. You recall when following the election dispute, the election 2012 dispute, the whole of Ghana didn't have to wait until the determination of the case before the president was sworn in, because constitutionally election declaration had been made, and in greatest regard for constitutional dictates, the president had to be sworn in within the time he had to be sworn in. Even though there was a pending court case, the determination of the court case did not have to, you know, hold and suspend a constitutional mandate that has to be fulfilled. That can be referred here. That's, yes, at any point in time, one may have a legal concern. You can go and battle it in the court. That should not stop the whole of Ghana from constituting the leadership of the Electoral Commission.
But if you recall again, at that time, for that eight months, I mean, things were not happening in the country.
But we had a sworn-in president. Yeah. That is the fundamental fact. Again, you know, there were broad-based consultations. That NDC has consistently been raised reservations, even some unfounded, even in the case of their own party member, a former presidential running mate and former Attorney General Minister of Justice, when they had unjustifiably raised reservations at his appointment. I would have expected even members of MPP to raise reservations at the appointment of Mr. Martin Amidu. But we were satisfied, considering his integrity, considering his qualifications, his suitability and attributes, and the qualities he brought to bear to the office. Now, so it's just a trajectory which consistently the NDC had, even though they concede that indeed the character, the fairness, neutrality, and the competences of Madame Jane Mensah are not in dispute, maybe, perhaps, for some political strategy, just so that in the future, perhaps, when they consistently may be losing, they may have occasion to raise one or two issues. Now, let me submit here that MPP has never had to, you know, appoint a chairperson of the Electoral Commission in the history of our Fourth Republic. But we had won at least some of the elections. We didn't have to appoint an electoral commissioner win those elections. Really, MPP does not need an appointment of an electoral commissioner to win elections. Now again, my respected
colleague... So there are no plans of rigging an election at all?
That is... My respected colleague and I, you know, have had several occasions where we had engaged with Madame Jane Mensah. So can I conclude that on the occasions where I saw my respected colleague engage with Madame Jane Mensah, makes her an NDC person? No, that argument is tenable. That you saw, granted, there is even any evidence that Madame Jane Mensah at any point in time.
An individual.
A stalwart of the NDC.
That's why I didn't even want to go there.
Yeah,
I just said
exactly.
That.
Right.
No,
your point is not disputed.
The Council of State, because of time,
yeah.
The Council of State is yet to submit its advice to the president on, you know, his nominations. I remember Benefson believes that if the NDC has got, you know, some evidence of statement made by Madame Mensah against her party or their party, they can forward it to the Council of State. Does the party again intend to petition the Council of State? Rashid, what do you think the party...
I do support the idea that where you have concrete evidence against somebody who you suspect might not have the kind of neutral... might not present that neutrality to bear on our electoral process, it's good that you bring them up. Actually, it should have been brought up even before the nomination.
Mm.
But now that it has been done, the cat is put before the horse, then we would need to go back and convince the people of Ghana why we are objecting. So it's important that happens. That way we have that view, we should present it to the appropriate quarters. I'm not too sure whether it's the Council of State, which has no clout and cannot change anything at all.
Really?
The Council of State cannot change anything. It is the advice of the Council of State.
Do you think we should scrap that Council of State?
No, I don't think so. I think that we should make it much more
powerful,
independent, and much more worthy of a house that can take decisions and that can take the president on and that can advise the president and for which advice can be binding on him. But where the advice is not binding, its existence is next to nothing, as if it doesn't exist at all. We can make it stronger, in fact. But, you know, he kept talking about Martin Hamidou and da 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 da. If you have somebody, it doesn't matter whether he has aligned to NDC or MPP, who consistently said, your government is corrupt, your president is a corrupt president, you did this, you are looters, and provided all the negative ammunitions for them to be campaigning against us, you know, talking about corruption and et cetera, et cetera. And that person is brought to become a special prosecutor, a person who should be neutral and looking at issues objectively about people. And then we cannot question why he did not have concrete evidence and was calling people corrupt, calling the whole government corrupt, calling people looters. And when we question it, you are saying NDC is questioning something that they shouldn't have questioned. Then where is the meaning of what's the meaning of the opposition? So I think that this issue is an important issue. Mm. And I think that if my party decides to go every length in bringing out its opinion about it, it's important. Just remember when Charlotte Osei was appointed, even some MPP members said that when they come to power, they will remove her. To the extent, they were so angry and so aggressive about it that they made all kinds of pronouncements about her, you know. So, and that's what the Constitution allows us to do.
Right, but I know Article 70 Clause 2 mandates the president to appoint an EC chair and their deputies.
Mm.
With the problem we are currently facing, many have, you know, raised concerns that the president should be, you know, stripped of its power. Do you agree? Maybe Ntim, you take that. Do you agree? He shouldn't be allowed so much to be involved
latitude,
in, you know, yes.
So much.
You know, just before I respond to that, I just want to establish, you know, the clarity here. That 45 Article 1 forces of the Constitution, which stipulates the procedures for removal of the Electoral Commission,
the electoral commissioner was not, you know, removed by speculation, were removed by evidence and all constitutional processes done. However, I would want to seek this occasion to congratulate her and to, you know, recognize the creditable aspects of the job she delivered. She delivered a free and fair election.
Madame Charlotte Osei.
Yes, Madame Charlotte Osei, and that and the other deputies. And that cannot be taken away from her. However, the issues that actually bordered on competences, bordered on breaches of, you know, procurement acts, these were specific, you know, allegations and counter-allegations which the committee looked into, which in some occasions the accused or the defendant conceded to. And so these were breaches of matters of procurement laws, which are to the core of the mandate of elections, because electoral commission does elections, referendum, they procure machines, material in all their activities that they engage in. And so procurement is one very core. And if there were those established breaches, unfortunately, as they were established, then their removal were occasioned. So I cannot gloat over the removal of Madame Charlotte Osei, but I would also be honest enough to commend her where she creditably
So yes, yeah. So coming to the now, issue, do you think that president should be, you know, stripped of its power not to
In my view, and in all philosophy of constitutional jurisprudence, I do not see where the president should be stripped off of his powers. I believe that he has optimum powers, and then we have optimum constitutional structures that support the discharge of the executive mandate of government. At this point in time, my concern has been the seeming vacuum that arises when the president, in the absence of the president and the vice president, and who acts in the Speaker of Parliament, which we would probably we'll have to review and look at, which the necessary constitutional processes in due course may be occasioned and may be triggered. That is my observation. But I do not see a reason why the president should be stripped of any powers.
Do you share some love views?
I think that it's a very serious question and a serious concern about the kind of system we operate. We are operating a hybrid system, a presidential and a ministerial system of government, and that should reflect in the personality or the persona of the president, but it does not. And that's a contradiction and a conflict between what we are doing, the presidential and the prime ministerial systems of government. If you want to have a hybrid system, you should have the hybrid system appear in the functions and strength and abilities of the president. If you decide on the hybrid, and you still want to keep a strong presidential personality, you know, then I don't know how that comes into being. In other words, you have in the ministerial system all ministers coming from parliament. You have in the presidential system where none of the ministers should come from parliament, but we decided to blend the two. Now, when you blend the two, you should give powers, some of the powers of the president to parliament, so that he doesn't decide everything. But if he's still a strong president, as if we are in a presidential system of administration, and then you still have members of parliament, some coming from parliament, and members of the executive, some coming from parliament, you would not expect any member of parliament to contradict him in his party, because he will have expectations that one day the president will appoint him. And so he would not normally criticize the president.
Careful of what he says.
Yes. So I do agree with the many people who are thinking that we have gotten to the stage where we have experienced the hybrid system enough, and that there is a need for us to re-examine how that can play out if we limit, not strip off, limit some powers of the president, so that we can hold him much more responsible. Right now, as we have in the system, the president appoints everybody, all officers who have who Article 71 officers, all are appointed apart from the judges. They are appointed by the president. He dismisses them as he wishes. He takes decisions, and then, you know, he can sign executive orders. If cabinet is not agreeing with him, he can ignore cabinet and sign an executive order. He does everything. One man who has so much powers in his hands that He can do anything with it. So it's important that
moving on, a quick one.
You know, in itself, as I agree that if there are opportunities for us to explore because of the winner takes all issues, because of we still have a lot of tests to go through with a hybrid system. But even in itself, as the status quo is, the legislature holds a lot of powers, even in holding the executive accountable. Most of these, all of these appointments, as my respected colleague has enumerated, are all subject to approval by Parliament. And so it is important that we encourage institutions to be strengthened, and then the oversight responsibility of the legislature, you know, strengthened such that, yes, there may be some of the members of Parliament that are appointed on the executive, but that is in minority compared with the rest of the members of Parliament. And Parliament must be recognized as an institution, foremost. And so in all agreements, even international agreements of that the President has taken, it's subject to ratification by Parliament. So Parliament in itself has powers in matters where they disagree with decisions of the President to so state. And that is what we must encourage at this point in time. But again, it's a general concern that the winner-takes-all system has to be looked at. And for us, for a section of the people have also observed that our institutions have some maturing to do, to the extent that when one party seems to vacate government and there's transition, and then there are some individuals who are even heading institutions that are seen to be leaning towards a certain political party, will either have to be leaking, you know, documents of the other party. And these things have run through various transitions. We've had several turnovers and they've reflected. And so we're able to build our institutions about partisanship. And we're able to, you know, morally as a society, develop our people beyond, to rise above partisanship. Then we'll begin to explore these opportunities.
We'll be right back.
As it stands now, I have my fears.
We'll be right back.
When you dream.
Are you searching for something new in education for your child? Look no further. Alpha White Park Academy is here. Imagine an institution with a mission to facilitate the holistic development of every child enrolled. Imagine a school that provides excellent teaching, grounded in godly character, without any form of discrimination. Imagine an academy with a well-equipped computer lab and a library stocked with relevant books. Your imaginations are within reach with Alpha White Park Academy. At Alpha White Park Academy, a multi-skilled and Montessori approach is incorporated into our scheme for your child and infant school. We combine Ghana Education Service and other globally relevant curricula for your child in primary and junior high levels to have the best of educational experience. Our staff are highly qualified and well motivated to care for your child's every need. Security is provided to ensure safety of your child. Locate Alpha White Park Academy at number AE401/10. Aquile Kaswa, behind the Living God and close to the Credit Union Training Center. Digital address code is CX0443030. Call us on 0502-261-944 or 0544-188-045. Rush now to Alpha White Park Academy and enroll your child. Alpha White Park Academy. Education makes.
When you dream, dream big.
Welcome back. You are still watching The Hard Truth. Member of Parliament for West Central, Honorable Rashid Pelpuo is here, and a Member of Parliament for Assin South Constituency, Ntim Fordjour, is also here. Rashid, the 2018 budget was under the theme Putting Ghana Back to Work. I remember the Finance Minister has, you know, presented the budget review to Parliament. Now, does this review give you the indication that the government is really, really putting Ghana back to work?
Well, if you realize, the opposition to the budget was so aggressive, even to the point that we thought that there was illegitimacy in how the budget came to be because of a previous budget review figures which were not meant to have been altered, but which were altered and transferred into the budget. So that budget from the word go was very controversial. there is a government that profess to make the economy a working economy, and that profess to stimulate the private sector as the lead agency to ensure that it props up employment. And that same budget was using the consolidated fund to employ 600,000 workers or young school leavers, you know, not from the private sector, but from government-owned resources. So you don't know what future they are going to hold for themselves. And so from that period up to now, you cannot see that even hasn't taken off yet. They have quite engaged them now in the process of making sure that thing happen. But it has not gotten them to start work. The private sector, which we all thought would be engineered to take the lead, according to what the budget was professing, stimulating the economy, making sure we get people to work rather than tax, is a negation of what happened. You now see more taxes coming on. You now see, you don't see businesses being propped up. And you see investments coming down. Investment presupposes increase in job creation. Investments since 2017 has decreased in the country. And so you don't know what exactly the budget was looking for.
Mm.
Yeah, it's talking about one thing and then achieving something else.
Right, because even the macroeconomic environment has, you know, improved. The mid-year budget review is also painting a bleak picture about the state of the economy. Revenue and expenditure targets, you know, were missed technically, and wages, salaries and interest payment before for the period under review consumed more than, you know, the total tax revenue. Isn't this worrying, Ntim?
Yeah, I would say that statistically speaking, and the records are there to show, Ghana was challenged economically at the time that we took power in January 2017, where growth has stunted at 3.7% within a year of transition. It had grown to 8.5%. Now, interest rate, and matters of interest rate is one that is very important because of its implications for businesses, recognizing that, you know, the private sector is the engine of growth, then you would want to set the macro physicals congenial to be able to energize them to expand. But if you're running a regime where policy rates is hovering around 25.5% in the previous administration, then your lending rate will likely hit 42%, 35%, as was seen previously. That led to a lot of companies either crippling or running into non-performing loans. Because what kind of business in Ghana, on the average, can earn one, you know, a profit beyond 30%. So that fundamentally was troubling. But as we speak, we've even seen the policy rate further reduce and 17% as the policy rate,
which progressively... I ask this question a lot. When will it reflect in the pockets of Ghana?
It does reflect. And let me put to you the reflection here. Now, there were let me correct this fact that there had not been additional, you know, taxes. We had abolished 15 taxes, nuisance taxes, and the abolishment
added some somewhere else.
The taxes that we introduced were the above the 10,000 earning band, an additional 10% into the 25% within 10,000 cities. Any extra attracts 10%. That was something that is for high earners. And then the V8s and luxury vehicles that are above 3.0 liters will also have to attract a levy, which was done. Now, VAT, contrary to the expectation of the minority, that considering how challenged the economy that we inherited was and some of the challenges that our revenue mobilization had also seen, the only way out was to increase VAT, which we didn't. Rather, we sought to just disintegrate so that they stand alone. VAT 12.5% stands alone. We have the get fund component 2.5% stands alone as a levy, as well as the NHIS component also stand alone. But here, responding to money reflecting the pockets of the people in economic, Doc is also has a very recognized economics background, and he appreciates what I'm saying, that at the abolishment of the 15 taxes that was seen, it could have raised close to 1.5 billion cedis for the government in revenue. revenue. In abolishing that alone, an implication for our revenue is 1.5 in excess of that billion cedis. Now, when we came, that is money put in the pockets of people. For instance, if the Kayi were to pay 1 cedi a day, and now that had been cancelled and she's not paying,
it's called levy.
It is in her pocket. The 17.5% VAT on domestic airline tickets. If Doc is to now board the airline from Accra to Tamale, that 17.5% is savings in household, in their pockets. The VAT, 17.5%, for instance, VAT on financial services, is now savings. Again, when we come to the reduction in tariffs, electricity tariffs, 17.5% for residential, 30% reduction for non-residential, and then 10% on non-special load, all these translates into 1.84 billion cedis. So this 1.84 billion cedis revenue that could have hitherto been taken, collected from pockets and businesses, remain with the households, remain in individual pockets, remain with companies so they can expand. Again, the subsidy on fertilizers and the free SHS that was done, now as a parent of the nearly 393,000 students who save close to 3,500 cedis every term. That is savings in their pocket. So, for instance, if a parent engages in charcoal business or cocoa business, that is savings for them to now purchase additional bags of charcoal or maize
let's move on.
So, again, but interestingly, what I also find interesting is the fact that our policies, economic policies, has responded, and the budget is the most paramount economic policy of the government, responded to the real needs of the people. Policies must not be made in isolation with the needs of the people, like Doc rightly mentioned from the outset, that when we are crafting our policies and interventions, it must be targeted at the real needs of the people. We will all recognize that unemployment is one major challenge among the youth.
Indeed.
So if we have brought up NAPCO, that is to employ 100,000, that is great. And then again,
let's move on. Indeed.
Now the Sino-Hydro.
Let's look at the free SHS. There's always been policy should be targeted and not, you know, wholesale. The finance minister, Ken Ofori-Atta, recently suggested that moving the free SHS should be targeted at persons with, you know, genuine and need and not to benefit everyone. Has a chicken come to roost, Rashid?
Yeah, I think that, as I said, the government, the economy is struggling us at the moment. With all the sing-song about the economy doing well and they have left these taxes, not taxes, it's all part of their failure, the general failure the economy is experiencing. Now, you are looking for fiscal space to expand your investment, government state investment. You want to spend money to do things. And you are the same person going ahead to say these taxes are nuisance, you cut them for political expediency. And now, having done that and having suffered a number of budget revenue falls, failures, target failures, they are going back to now tax the people much more than they were being taxed, you know, in ways that we have never seen before. Luxury cars, you have to tax them a year, you have to, you know, tax people who earn 10,000, you have to tax you know, the straight tax that they are talking about, saying they have reduced, it is worse than the VAT taxes that we are experiencing. If you do the calculations, it's worse off. The Ghanaians should brace themselves up. There are more taxes that are going to be experienced, and it is not as if it is something that we don't anticipate. Every government would experience a situation of shortages, and so you'll find novel ways by which you can make money. It doesn't seem like they have the idea of capacity to generate new ideas about making money. After condemning taxes and saying, we are not going to tax people, and then going back to it. We are not going to take loans and going back to it. They have taken so much loan. We have seen nothing for it. They are not going to tax the people. Hopefully, we should see something on that. So,
but addressing the free SHS issue.
So the free senior high is, I'm just linking the two. Because of the difficulty they are facing and the challenge of the free senior high, you need infrastructure. They did not plan towards it. Look, if you talk about, they spent 4 years talking, in fact, 8 years talking about free senior high. And so they should have been prepared enough to now do a feasibility, come out with a concrete plan and come out with a cost element, you know, about it. So that in the end, you'll be implementing it in a more fluent manner than we are seeing today. Now, it's as if it's a guest job. They want to see whether by saying free, they can find the money from somewhere. Remember when Nana was campaigning in 2012, they asked him where he was going to find the money and how much does it cost to his thinking. He said it was 78 million Ghana cedis he was going to spend. And you know, now implementing one semester will cost you 1.something billion Ghana cedis. So it means he missed the target. He didn't know what it was all about. So not knowing the animal they were dealing with is what is haunting them now. And we are all in trouble because the free senior high is going to fail if we are consistently going to go along with this line of lack of money, lack of space, lack of feeding grants, inability to employ more teachers, and inability to pay the existing allowances and others, and then you expect it to produce quality human beings. It's not possible. Mm. We have a challenge. And I want us to all come on board.
There's a shift system, we hear. There's something, what's it called again?
Yeah, it's not a shift system. It's a multi-track system. I would explain that if you may indulge me. President Akufo-Addo, right at the outset, and the government and the MPP, we had always been very certain of what we were about and what we meant as free education for the people. We had concrete plans and we had very timeous plans. Broad-based consultations had been done. Now, there hasn't been any financing challenge of the financing of free SHS so far.
Oh.
So far, there hasn't been any finance challenge. There hasn't, payments are not in arrears. Now, with the multi-track system that is practiced in most schools in the United States, it is practiced in Japan, it is practiced in Costa Rica, it is practiced in Kenya, it is practiced also extensively in Australia. What we are saying is that we already have plans. One can just set, and as we said here, we can just project how the population growth for our first cycle institutions and by second cycle institutions, tertiary institutions, even giving the basis of population growth 2.5% every year. We can just simply simulate and know how our growth will increase. Now, as we speak, the third years that are going to exit, free SHS were 181,000. So technically speaking, we have spaces for 181,000. However, we have 472,000 students from BEC who are going to be admitted into second cycle institutions. Mm. Now, if Doc makes reference to we lacking plans to build, we have plans. Mm. Our plan is to foremost, to educational infrastructure, is to foremost complete all the projects that at various stages of completion, whether it was started by President Kufuor, President Mills, President Mahama, we have to complete the taxpayers' money. Let us complete those ones first. Then additional ones will be started and move away from the trajectory and the narrative of every party wanting to start a project.
The finance minister is saying, let's start the conversation.
Yes. So the commitment is there to complete them. But now, even if you have to build,
where is that
by industry standards, it takes 24 months to build. And in all fairness, that is the reason why when President Mahama sought to build how many schools? 200 schools. Right. Only 11 were able to be completed.
Oh, no.
Let us be circumspect here. If we're even going to build or complete those infrastructure, we cannot have it done within this short space of time. So what we are doing is to think outside the box, find innovative ways and brilliant ways of not jeopardizing the accessibility of high school to our children, but how can we, have a track where we can have one stream going on and then have a semester system. Then when they're on vacation, another stream also gets on. The closest example outside is a sandwich system at the university level, where one stream goes on vacation.
Because of time.
That's how it's going to be.
But however, this double track is only going to affect the new entrants. But the second years are going to get on to the semester system. But the third years are just going to complete their regular system.
That's the failure we are talking about. This thing was not envisaged until a professor comes out to say, why don't you do the track system? And then the minister picked on it. The next moment, government has announced that they will do the track system. This is ad hoc policy approach. We need concrete approach to policy. Where from the word go, you come on board and you say, look, because of the progressive, we have been asked to introduce free senior high education in the constitution progressively. We thought that doing so should mean that we provide the infrastructure, then we make day school free, then we gradually face it to reach all others. They came and said, let's do it all at once. And then they were hailed. Political expediency. They go into it only to realize that, look, you need infrastructure, you need money, you need teachers, you need that. And then they are stuck. Only for somebody to make a casual observation, and then they're picked on it. So I think that we need to be much more serious in our approach to education. We should not politicize education. They have politicized education to the point where we now cannot have an objective view of education. Since when have we thought that a double-track system or multi-track system was what we wanted? Nobody has ever mentioned it during the campaign or during in their manifesto. It's not there, but it's a major policy decision. So it only came out within the few weeks. When they got stuck, they didn't know what to do.
Well, because of time.
And they also said that there was
because of time, gentlemen. Yeah. No, Ntim, you had your turn.
Just briefly.
We'll talk about, I think.
In policy making.
We are done. We talk about The Meaning of Life, a new book by Honorable Rashid Pelpuo. Rashid, tell us about your book.
Well, this is basically poetry with some interlacing prose, you know, and it's about the definition of life in general, as we can find in our politics, as we can find in our fight for liberation and freedom, as we can find in our love and our despair.
So what inspired you to write this?
I'm inspired to write this because of my experience about what life is.
Okay.
You know, throughout my life, I have had come into situations where I need to put down what I think. And I do so in poetry, which I love so much. And so in reading a poem, you come out after understanding what the poet has written. It's like reading a whole book. Just one poem can give you an impression you have read a whole book. You've had a whole life experience. So it's a very experiential kind of writing that I have done.
It's a great book. Yeah. So if you need one, is it out already?
Yeah, it's out, but it's yet to be launched.
Oh, okay. So I can launch it here. So we launch The True Meaning of Life, a collection of poems by Rashid Pelpuo, Honorable Dr. Rashid Pelpuo, in the name of God the Father, also who is here, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you so much for your time. You've been watching The Hard Truth, and we are proudly brought to you by Murphy Holmes, Dawa Industrial City, and Pulse Fitness Gym, and Weisbach Academy. My name is Nana Akosia Kunedu Asante Samuel. Catch a repeat of the program tomorrow morning. It's at 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. Thank you so much for watching. Have a good night. Bye.